The earliest economic thinkers can be traced back as far as the ancient Greek philosophers. Though most scholars would agree that Adam Smith, author of The Wealth of Nations, is the father of modern mainstream economic thought. However, it may come as a surprise to many that a man named Ibn Khaldun wrote on economic theories and concepts that are undeniably similar to those of Smith's, approximately four centuries earlier, and has gone largely unrecognized in discussions of history of economic thought. These discoveries that Khaldun made long before Smith include recognizing labor as a source of wealth and the productivity increase resulting from the division of labor. Other classical and neoclassical ideas can also be found in his book, Mukaddima, including discussions of trade, population, taxes, and the labor theory of value. Ibn Khaldun was born on May 27, 1332, in present-day Tunisia. His family was affiliated with the Hafsid dynasty, ruling North Africa at the time. Having been born into aristocracy, he received a formal Islamic education, studying at Ez-Zetouna University, and later assuming political office. His political career would last from 1352 to 1375, during which he served on the court of Tunis as a secretary for the Sultan of Morocco and prime minister of Egypt. Due to ever-emerging conflicts, Khaldun often relocated himself and his family between North Africa and Spain. At one point, he spent nearly 2 years in prison, having been accused of partaking in a rebellion. Despite his hectic political career, Khaldun never stopped studying historiology, sociology, demography, and of course, economics. Immediately following his retirement, Khaldun began writing his book Mukaddima, from which his great economic discoveries can be found. Perhaps one of Khaldun's most forward-thinking discoveries came from identifying labor rather than gold as a country's source of wealth. He writes, "Treasures of gold, silver, precious stones, and utensils are no different from other minerals and acquired capital. It is civilization that causes them to appear with the help of human labor, and that makes them increase or decrease. The common people think that the prosperity of other nations is a result of the existence of gold and silver mines in their country. This is not so. A large civilization yields large profits because of the large amount of available labor, which is the cause of profit." This is shockingly similar to what Adam Smith wrote in his Wealth of Nations, published 400 years earlier. Even so, the idea that gold and silver was a nation's source of wealth was not a widely held opinion until mercantilism became the dominant ideology in the 16th century. More specifically, the mercantilists believed that nations generate wealth by maximizing exports and minimizing imports. Khaldun instead argued that the product of labor, in excess of what is needed to provide subsistence to its workers, is the true wealth of a nation. This concept would later become known as the surplus labor of value. But Khaldun did not stop there. He extended this idea by suggesting that specialization, or the division of labor, is necessary for human survival. He writes, "The power of the individual human being is not sufficient for him to obtain the food he needs, and does not provide him with as much food as he requires to live. Each of these operations requires a number of tools and many more crafts than those just mentioned. It is beyond the power of one man to do all of that by himself. Thus, he cannot do without a combination of many powers from among his fellow beings, if he is to obtain food for himself and for them. Through cooperation, the needs of a number of persons, many times greater than their own number, can be satisfied." Thus, Khaldun can take credit for another one of Adam Smith's claims to fame. While Smith did not proclaim the division of labor as necessary for survival, he emphasized the great increases in productivity resulting from it. He attributes this increase to three factors in his Wealth of Nations. Number one, the improvement in the dexterity of the workmen. Number two, the saving of time commonly lost from passing from one species of work to another. And three, the invention of machines that enable one man to do the work of many. Ibn Khaldun identified the first of these attributes. He writes, "As the days follow upon one another, the craftsmen become experienced in their various crafts and skilled in the knowledge of them. Long periods of time and the repetition of similar experiences add to establishing the crafts and to cause them to be firmly rooted." Given that industrial capitalism was centuries away from Khaldun's time, to make these discoveries so early on was remarkable. Similar to Adam Smith, Khaldun ties this idea back to his original discovery by advocating for the surplus value resulting from specialization to be traded with other cities. By exporting the excess production to those who need it, nations may accumulate wealth. What both of these discoveries have in common is that Khaldun recognized the labor theory of value long before Smith's time. The idea that goods have value because labor was put into making them. This concept will be expanded by David Ricardo and become the central component of Karl Marx's critique of industrial capitalism. Yet again, Khaldun further developed this idea by explaining how price systems operate in the short run and long run. When there is increased demand for a particular good, both wages and price associated with that good will subsequently rise. Over time, this incentivizes others to join the profession, increasing the supply of labor and bringing wages and price back down. He applies these same principles to goods markets. When goods are in short supply, prices naturally rise. What external factors may cause demand for goods to increase? Khaldun explained that population increases cause available labor to increase, in turn increasing demand for luxury goods and services. In general, Khaldun argued that the larger the population of a civilization, the more luxurious of a life its inhabitants will live. This is because more value is realized as the labor force increases, boosting profits and production. Again, here we see Khaldun recognizing labor and production as a nation's source of wealth and prosperity. However, his ideas on population growth were somewhat more optimistic than those of later classical thinkers. Economists such as Thomas Malthus argued that the population growth prevents wages from ever rising above the subsistence level, and that future generations would perish if the means of providing subsistence did not increase at the same rate. Essentially, he was saying that there will be an excess supply of labor along with food shortages. This presentation is not about Malthus, but long story short, new technologies in agriculture would prove him wrong. Smith, on the other hand, followed along Khaldun's line of thinking. Smith wrote, "To complain about growing population is to lament over the necessary effect and cause of the greatest public prosperity." This sounds a lot like what Khaldun wrote about the impact of population growth. Finally, Khaldun also had some ideas that modern neoclassical economists have cited in support for their policies. On the demand side, his theory of asabia has been compared to Keynesian economics. Generally speaking, Keynes argued that aggregate demand has a strong influence on economic output and national income. Consequently, aggregate demand can also be generated through government spending. Khaldun supposedly conceptualized the idea of the fiscal multiplier, a ratio indicating the change in national income per change in government spending. Khaldun's ideas contrasted with Keynes in that Khaldun believed that the government's propensity to save led to economic depression, whereas Keynes said that the saving habits of the middle class were to blame. Khaldun's work can also be compared to the supply side of neoclassical economics. This theory argues for lowering taxes, deregulation, and free trade to best foster economic growth. Even President Ronald Reagan acknowledged that Khaldun's ideas on taxation were strikingly similar to those of Arthur Laffer, an economic advisor in the Reagan administration. Khaldun explained that in response to the increasing luxurious needs of a civilization, the government may need to raise taxes. Eventually, taxes will become so high that the empire falls. In general, he argues, less revenue is collected from high tax rates. He writes, "It should be known that at the beginning of the dynasty, taxation yields large revenue from small assessments. At the end of the dynasty, taxation yields a small revenue from large assessments." What Khaldun is describing will later become known as the Laffer curve in the 1980s. The Laffer curve is a model of taxation that suggests an optimal tax rate exists in which revenue is maximized. The curve is shaped like an upside-down U, with the tax rate on the x-axis and the revenue collected on the y-axis. Increasing the tax rate beyond a certain point decreases tax revenue because it discourages production. Of course, Arthur Laffer did not claim to invent this concept, giving credit to Khaldun as an early advocate of supply-side economics. Furthermore, Khaldun also called for minimal government involvement in trade. In conclusion, Ibn Khaldun's ideas were centuries ahead of his time. Many of the excerpts from his Muqaddimah are like reading from a modern-day economics textbook. Having correctly identified the mechanisms we know today, parallels can be drawn between his works and those of great classical and neoclassical economists. Perhaps why Khaldun's work has gone largely unrecognized serves as an example of Islamic achievements being unfairly disregarded in the Western world. Even as an Islamic scholar in the Middle Ages, Khaldun's methodological thinking was new for its time. The role of historians was to serve as the trustworthy transmitter of knowledge, relaying information without altering tradition. Khaldun took a different approach, establishing social sciences as a discipline and applying the scientific method to separate fact from fiction. For this reason, Ibn Khaldun should join the ranks in being regarded as one of the great worldly philosophers.